Many events happened before the reopening of the Dark Portal, and honestly, covering them all would be the fever dreams of a madman since, well... Therefore, in brief, Ragefire Chasm is a volcanic cavern nestled deep beneath Orgrimmar, filled with Ragefire Trogs that Magatha Grimtotem, a despicable Tauren shaman, attempted to negotiate with and failed. The cavern also served as a refuge for the Searing Blade. The Searing Blade was a small-scale demonic cult on the surface, but in truth served as one of many similar such cells in the Greater Shadow Council, along with the cult of the Dark Strand in the west and the Argus Wake in the east. Each of these groups was routed and destroyed. Mancric, one of the surviving Burning Blade orcs, fought alongside his wife Ulgra in battling Quillbores of the Barrens. Sadly, this battle did not go well for them, resulting in his injury and her passing. The Wailing Caverns were found by the venerated archdruid Narlex, who believed he could tap into the Emerald Dream and use the lush waters of the cavern to help rejuvenate the Barrens. This endeavor did not go overly well for him, as once connected to the dream, he accidentally tapped into the Emerald Nightmare, still channeling the druidic magics into the caverns. Many people had gone with Narlex, and as a result, they were the first casualties of this breach to the Nightmare. Their minds twisted, they renamed themselves the Druids of the Fang, and each one of them had to be dealt with before it was possible to try and awaken Narlex. Scarlet Leaf was the first to volunteer for Narlex's mission, and the first to have her mind shattered by the Nightmare, restyling herself Lady Anacondra. Narlex's childhood friend Aaron was a relatively untested druid, and, unfortunately, was completely defenseless against the corruption. Jarlaxle was renowned for his skill in shapeshifting, and thus twisted himself into a new serpentine form after falling. Kresh is just kind of hanging out, honestly. It's possible he doesn't even notice the Nightmare corruption. Scum, not so fortunate. His veins pulse with energy that causes him as much pain as his enemies. Narlex's greatest student was rather ambitious, seeking to be Shando himself, and as such, he styled himself Lord Serpentis and took control of the Druids of the Fang upon his corruption. Verdun the Everliving was possibly the original guardian of the caverns, and as such, was even more susceptible than the druids. You see, the closer one is connected to the natural world, the more vulnerable one is to the Nightmare. And finally, the Nightmare manifested directly in the form of Narlex's worst enemy, Murloc, Mutanus, which served as jailer to ensure Narlex would never be freed. Thankfully, Narlex was freed, thanks in part to the efforts of Muyo and some adventurers, allowing him to escape and plan for how best to proceed in his continued goal to reclaim the Barrens. Hemet Nessingwary was already something of a legendary dwarven hunter and a career safarist who was seeking his next grand adventure in the jungle wilds of Stranglethorn Vale. He was having some issues with his book, though. Stalvin Mistmantle was a personal tutor and instructor at Moonbrook, who grew romantically attached to a young woman, Taloa. She did not grow romantically attached back. One thing led to another, and Stalvin butchered her, her groom-to-be, and an unknown number of other innocents, before retreating into the Duskwood. He was hunted down, and on official orders from the Nightwatch, executed for his horrific crimes. The Thandol Span was constructed both to symbolize the connections between the Bronzebeard and the Wildhammer Dwarven clans, and to practically connect the two for mutual defense and trade. A Dark Iron attack was intended to destroy the bridges, and succeeded for one, failed for the other, thanks to the bravery of several dwarves, including Ebenezer Rustlock and Sully Baloo. Erugal the Archmage was a devout patriot of Gelnaeus and the Royal Magician, a position he most likely earned through trickery and adherence to Gilnean doctrine rather than any actual magical skill. In the wake of the Scourge invasion of the Third War, he fled home to Gelnaeus and was promptly tasked with finding a method to combat the roaming damned. Erugal, hesitantly, mentioned the Worgen, a condition that Erugal, incorrectly, believed was a distinct race from a distant planet. King Greymane ordered the summoning of these Worgen against the Scourge. This went about as well as can be expected. Aragal himself, for reasons probably best left to the imagination, decided this was the perfect time to form his own Worgen cult and take over the local Shadowfang keep. Between the Forsaken, who were already pushing into the region, and the Kirin Tor, who were sent to check on Aragal's progress in combating the local undead, Aragal did not live particularly long, and the Forsaken claimed ownership of the keep. The Hillsbred foothills were no stranger to bloodshed, being the initial landing point of the demonic horde during the onset of the Second War. Similarly, Dernhold Keep resided within the foothills, the location where the abusive drunk Aedalus Blackmore had raised the orc orphan thrall, leading to Blackmore's death, the keep's destruction, and the foundation of the new horde. And finally, in more modern times, it serves as a border between the Forsaken and the Alliance, between the outposts of Terran Mill and South Shore, respectively. While not in a state of open warfare, border skirmishes between the Forsaken and South Shore people are quite common. Merin Nagenfager was a brilliant alchemist who lived in the Steamweedle Cartel's capital city of Gadgetzan, out in the dusty dunes of the Tanaris Desert. While someone of relatively little repute and position, he was able to craft copious clever concoctions, including the patented Nagenfager elixir. Tyrion Fordring was one of the first paladins of the Silver Hand, alongside legends such as Uther, Tyrellion, Gavinrad, and Dathrahan. Knighted for the Second War, he later ended up giving assistance to an honorable orc named Eitrig, and was branded a traitor for his actions. He was stripped of everything, sent into exile, but despite this, Tyrion ended up saving Eitrig's life later, an act which led to not only a bond between the two, but a forging of friendship between Tyrion and the young orcish warchief Thrall, who had come to recruit Eitrig into the new horde. Tyrion remained in hiding to watch over his son, Talyn, from a distance. Unfortunately, he soon became aware of the fact that his son had joined the Scarlet Crusade. The Scarlet Crusade have a lengthy history, but its summary is thus. Founded by paladins to purge the undead, the group was swiftly infiltrated by a Nathrezim dreadlord, Balnazar, who killed and replaced Dathrahan. Balnazar used his new position to push it towards more and more fanatic zealotry, twisting it into a force of violence that could be directed towards the Nathrezim's enemies. This resulted in the death of the legendary Ashbringer Alexandros Mograine, among others. With the leadership overhauled, Balnazar used magical influence to ensure the obedience of the more sensible members of the group. Thus, free-willed or controlled, the Crusaders turned to gleeful torturing and murdering of innocents upon any provocation, proven or otherwise. Tyrion's son was under the same mental influence as the rest of the Crusade, and Tyrion sought to free him. Though successful, Talyn was murdered by Balnazar's agent Isilion. Tyrion vowed never again to remain passive in affairs, and journeyed to Light's Hope Chapel to rebuild the Knights of the Silver Hand. The venerable Stonemasons Guild were responsible for much of the distinct constructions of the Southern Kingdom of Stormwind. Nethergard Keep was assembled by them to watch over the Dark Portal, and they were tasked with the rebuilding of Stormwind City itself, a feat whose results speak for themselves. Sadly, thanks in no small part to a corrupt group of nobles headed by the Lady Catrana Prestor, the guild was left unpaid and ordered disbanded in the wake of their work. King Varian's wife was accidentally killed in a riot following this proclamation, and the guild's leader, Edwin Van Cleef, had to flee into Westfall along with many of his fellow artisans. Edwin and his people slowly garnered support from the disenfranchised and the outcast, as well as tacit support from Miss Prestor, and reforged themselves into the Defias Brotherhood. Thanks in no small part to their skill in coordination and craftsmanship, the Brotherhood were able to operate at a level most roaming bandit groups couldn't dream of. The Brotherhood counted as allies the Bloodsail Buccaneers, the Riverpaw Knoll Tribe, the Strashaw's Naga, and Rogue Goblins. Their long-term goal was the procurement of resources and personnel, the construction of a juggernaut, and an assault on Stormwind itself to destroy the House of Nobles. All of these plans went up in smoke when many of the upper echelons of the Brotherhood were assassinated by the People's Militia of Westfall. Many years ago, the declining Gurabashi Empire were driven to desperation by famine and foe alike, and turned towards a brutal Loa known as Hakkar the Soulflayer. The Loa empowered the Gurabashi trolls to butcher their way across the Stranglethorn Vale, but demanded daily sacrifices in return. In time, this led to a civil war that broke the back of the Gurabashi people, and their member tribes descended into continuous conflict one with another. Only the Darkspear tribe fled this madness, seeking a new life in the distant Darkspear Isles. In more modern times, a sect of Gurabashi called the Atalai, headed by Jindo the Hexer, worked in secret to trick adventurers into aiding the resurrection of the Loa within Zul-Gurub, the old Gurabashi capital. Hakkar quickly subdued several nearby Loas and used them to empower his Atalai followers, forcing a response from the ancient Zandalari trolls who assisted and empowered forces of the Horde in defeating the Atalai priests and slaying the Soul Flayer. Millennia ago, virtually every black dragon was corrupted by the old gods. Centuries ago, the Dark Iron Dwarves accidentally summoned the elemental Fire Lord Ragnaros into the Red Ridge Mountains, creating the Searing Gorge, Burning Steps, and the Black Rock Mountain in the middle. Both groups came to reside within the mountain and were in conflict one with another, the Fire Lord's forces down below, and the Black Dragons up above. The Dark Irons, in the depths of their great Shadowforge city, worked ceaselessly to prepare for war with, well, basically everyone. Unfortunately for them, they caught the ire of the adventurers, backed by the Hydraxian Waterlords of Neptalon, and they charged into the Molten Core and defeated Ragnaros, banishing him back to the Firelands. While this would seem to be a boon to the Black Dragonflight, the adventurers immediately turned Spireward, charging through the Blackwing Lair. Nefarian was continuing the schemes of his father Deathwing in attempting to create a new chromatic flight. Schemes which did not last particularly long in the face of heavily armed individuals. Ragnaros banished, Nefarian killed, the group returns home in triumph. Sadly, a hero's welcome was not awaiting them. Absent a king, aided by corrupt nobility, Stormwind had been under the effective control of Nefarian's sister, hiding as the Lady Catrana Prestor, for some time now. Thanks, however, to some shenanigans, the Black Dragon matron Onyxia was revealed and slain, returning Varian Rin to the crown. Meanwhile, about 16,000 years ago, the old gods Akir minions waged a colossal war against the dominant trolls, a war they lost. In the wake of this, the Akir shattered into three powers, Azhol Nerub and the Nerubians to the north, Mantaves and the Mantid to the south, and the Karaji in the sands of Silithus. A little under 1,000 years ago, one Fandral Staghelm sent his son Valstan to regrow the blasted desert. Valstan found and accidentally awoke the Karaji and their old god master C'Thun, leading to the War of the Shifting Sands. Fandral was able to unify a sizable force of Night Elves to push back the tides of the Karaji and their Silithid servitors, but the very public execution of Valstan before Fandral's eyes was too much for him, and his will and leadership faltered. The Karaji pushed all the way to Tanaris, accidentally awakening the ire of the Bronze Dragonflight, who swiftly recruited the other Dragonflights and joined the war. Ironic, since Fandral had earlier petitioned the Bronze Flight personally to aid them in this war, only to be rebuffed, as it was a lesser matter. With the aid of the dragons, they were able to drive the Karaji back to An-Karaj and seal them within the Scarab Wall. But Fandral never recovered, and in fact shattered the Scepter of the Shifting Sands, the keystone to the Scarab Wall, when offered it by the oh-so-helpful Bronze Flight. In more modern times, the patient Karaji had found cracks in the wall and used them to stretch their influence back into Silithus. In response to this, the Horde and Alliance joined forces into one massive army and surged into the dunes to combat the resurgent threat, led by the High Overlord Verok Sourfang, veteran of the First, Second, and Third Wars. The might of Kalimdor was able to reforge the scepter, charge into the Temple of An-Karaj, and slay the old god C'Thun, who is definitely dead, no really. With all these many, many, many issues resolved, everything works out fine forever for the people of Azeroth.